Last time I spoke about GANs, and a lot of people came up and asked me about super resolution. So I thought tonight I will do super resolution. For me, the whole theme of tonight, really though, is actually about CNNs. And kind of like Martin said, abusing CNNs or hacking CNNs or getting CNNs to do different things than sort of what most people think about. So actually, just before I start, can I ask quickly, like, how many people would consider themselves advanced in deep learning? A few people? Okay, how many are like total beginners? Okay, and how many sort of intermediate? Okay, so we've got maybe half-half, those two. Okay, good. So some of the things I'm going to explain should be really basic for the intermediate people, but I think it's sometimes really good to just go through these things and remind ourselves of what we're actually doing. So the first thing I wanted to show was just the concept of a simple neural network of basically how, with sort of like a traditional classification network, how we're building something that has, we've got our input, which might be a bunch of images, going into a bunch of hidden layers, which could be CNNs, could be MLPs, could be a whole bunch of different things. And then we use a loss function, which basically takes in the desired result, the result brought about by the CNNs, and we then calculate our loss and optimize our network. Everyone's clear with this, yes? So, then when it becomes an inference model, basically we just take the raw input, run our hidden layers with our saved weights, and come up with an output. There's no longer, we don't need to do anything. Like, that was what the TPU thing was. Basically, TPUs just work for inference. I want you to, to sort of constantly remind yourself about that. Because if you just start thinking about that sort of way of building something, or building a network, you can apply it to so many different things as long as you've got those key concepts. So, sort of classification CNNs generally fall into, most of them, there are certainly, changes and stuff like that, but generally you have your conv blocks, which is basically convolution layers. You've got some pooling in there. You've got an activation function like a ReLU or something like that. And the way that they work is that, there's a reduction in, say I've got the reduction in height and width, but there's an increased number of filters. So the depth becomes, everyone understands the CNN, right? Martin explained that last time. Then at the end, we've got these fully connected layers or dense layers, and we make a prediction. So what we're going to do tonight is we're going to talk about hacking it. And the way, big thing I want you to understand is that CNNs are not just for classification. CNNs really have a lot of magic to them. Don't fall into the trap of thinking CNNs are just a precursor to dense layers and logits and your predictions. If we actually hack off those fully connected layers, those dense layers, and just go with the conv blocks, the last layer of the conv blocks, or even an earlier layer of conv blocks, we've got all this wonderful information that basically describes what we're putting in a whole different way. And I think many of you understand that from sort of seeing Martin's lesson last time and this time of how CNNs sort of pick up relationships between the pixels. And what Martin, what was talking about tonight, what Martin was talking about tonight was the original style transfer paper. And it was basically all built around, at the start, a lot of the sort of ideas for style transfer were built around optimizing things on a pixel basis of looking at just, how do we sort of take a loss function on pixels? And then they realized, hence that paper, that well, CNNs can actually help this in a lot, in a big way. And the big thing I want you to take away from tonight is that generative CNN models can be used for almost anything where you want to put an image in and get an image out. I'll talk about that more later on. But constantly be thinking to yourself, if you've got some sort of task where you need to put an image in and get an image out, then generally you're going to want to do something like this, this kind of model. So this is, I think I just talked about this already, basically an old style CNN. You would basically have a bunch of conv blocks. You would start with a 3x3. In fact, I think this is very similar to sort of Dennis's structure for what he was doing of predicting, you know, some sort of output for steering. A modified CNN is where we cut the dense stuff off. We just deal with these all these layers that come out at the end. Okay, so the paper I'm going to be going through tonight is what we call perceptual losses for real-time style transfer and super resolution. And I'm going to be focusing on the super resolution part of it. This paper is now, a year old. It was done at Stanford. You may recognize some of the names. Fifi Li is quite, it now works for Google. Okay, so this is the model that we're going to be building tonight, or that I'm going to be talking about. We've got a whole bunch of different things going on. We've got a low-resolution image. This is for our training model, right? We've got a low-resolution image and a normal-resolution image. We're going to put the low-resolution image into one network, because we've actually got three different networks going on here. Our first network, what I've called the SR network, is basically upsampling the image. We put in a certain number of, of pixels, and it's going to generate more pixels than were there. Then what we're going to do is we're going to take that and we're going to stick it into a CNN. We're going to take the normal image and stick it into a CNN also. Both those CNNs are constructed exactly the same. And I happen to be using VGG, right? VGG16, which is just a very simple convolutional neural network, and I've just chopped off the ends of them. And what we're doing then is we're then taking those outputs of those two CNNs and using that to work out our loss. And then we don't optimize those two CNNs, right? The VGG networks, they're non-trainable. We're not using them for, we're not trying to train weights and things in them. They've already been trained on ImageNet. All right, so they understand a lot of things about images. And this is what we're sort of like hacking, and we're leveraging the concept of, of also of style transfer, that those networks have a bunch of sort of understanding about how images work and how lines work and how shapes work. And we basically take the output of those, get what we call our perceptual loss, and then we use that to then optimize our super resolution part of it, our upscaling network. So it's actually a very simple concept. When you sort of see it like this and start thinking about it like this, it can get complicated in code. But just constantly ask yourself, okay, which of the three sort of CNNs are we working with at any point in time? And understand that we're only trying to train and optimize one of them. Okay, the other big thing, is really important is to understand that the two VGG networks are actually part of our loss function. Most people don't think of a CNN as being part of your loss function, but these are actually using the VGG networks as a part of the loss function. Okay, so perceptual loss. I sort of described this before. You basically take the output features, right? Not some sort of prediction of a class or something like that, but we take the output features of both the normal resolution image and the low resolution image that's been upscaled to be of resolution equivalent to the normal one. And then we basically work out the difference of those, those two tensors. And then from that, we can basically work out, our perceptual loss, or mean squared error loss in this case. Okay, this is our upsampling CNN. So upsampling CNN, going from the bottom, going up, starts off with a one-by-one convolution. It's actually a one-by-one convolution with a 9x9 filter. All right, so this is something a little bit unusual. People would think, okay, why do we do a one-by-one convolution? The reason we do the one-by-one convolution is we're actually trying to get using it with a 9x9, we're actually trying to get a very big receptive field going with the image. So it allows the network to look at big chunks of the image and sort of get a sense of how parts of the image relate to another part of the image. Okay, then we come up into ResNet blocks. So I will go through what the blocks actually are, give you a sort of example of them, but we've got a couple of ResNet blocks. So these are residual network blocks. Then we basically increase the pixels by upsampling. And I will go through that a little bit as well, too. Then finally, we end up with another convolutional, with our output, and we're using a TAN activation rather than a ReLU activation, because we actually want the end activation to be between -1 and 1, which a TAN function gives us. Okay, so this is the concept of a receptive field. So if I walk over a bit, can I do that? You can see if we had, say, a 3x3 filter, and we're using it in a way that's going to give us a bigger receptive field, you can see that actually a 3x3 filter on the 3x3 input will give you a 5x5 receptive field. So you imagine if we're starting on 9x9, our receptive field is going to be quite big for the amount of inputs. That means that each filter, as we stack up the filters, are going to have their ability to sense something that's going on in that particular part of the image. Okay, let's look at the actual sort of the blocks themselves. So the conv block is very simple and very standard. You've basically just got your input going into a convolutional 2D layer. I'm doing some batch normalization once we come out of that, and then putting it into a ReLU activation function. The ResNet is a little bit different. I don't think we've talked about residual networks before. Okay, this is a different sort of architecture. I won't go into the math of it, but basically, think of it this way. Basically, a ResNet has two convolutional blocks. The second one doesn't have an activation function. And then what we do is we basically add the first bit, the bit what we call the identity, together at the top of it. So it allows the network to sort of store what it understands at one layer, do some more convolutions, then joins it together. So it's got the new convolutions, the sort of new understanding, and the old understanding together. The latest and greatest in CNNs at the moment would be what we call DenseNets and UNets. They do this on a much bigger scale. So they basically pass things around the network so that even at the last layer, you're often passing things that you saw in one of the earlier layers into it. So it makes the network have a much more sort of, it's very good for things like segmentation, where you want the network to really understand what's going on with each pixel. But this one is actually a very simple sort of residual block. Okay, so I've talked about this. So now you sort of see. So those bits, everything I was talking about there is just in our SRNet, right? Just in the super resolution network. Let's look at code. Okay, so what I've done is I've put this in Keras. How many people have used Keras before? I think when you're starting out, and even when you're trying to just sketch out ideas a lot of the time, Keras can be really good. Oh, thank you. Yes, I need to make it bigger. How's that? Better? Okay, so I basically just got my imports. And the data set I'm using is called the Celeb Faces data set. So basically, it's just a bunch of pictures of celebrity faces. And one of the fun things you can do with this data set is you can actually just take the mean of all the faces, and you can get this sort of like, what an average celebrity will look like. If you want to do that, right? I'll say some more about that later on. Okay, so basically, All I'm doing is loading in some bcalls arrays that I've already sort of pre-built with this information in them. Just allowing it to be faster for training, for accessing, and also it's just easier to pass around. Right. So here what I'm doing is I'm bringing in a bunch of different ones. I'm bringing in the original ones, which are 176 by 176 pixels. I'm bringing in what I call a low res, which is half that. Sorry, it was one fourth that. So that's basically 44 by 44. And then I'm also bringing in a set that I call the extra low res, which is, it's not in this one, it's in the 8 by 8 one. I'll show you that in a minute. Which is also gonna be basically at 1/8. So in this network, I'm doing 4 times super resolution. I'll show you a network after this that's doing 8 times super resolution. Okay, so because we're using VGG and it was trained on ImageNet, it already has a bunch of, obviously we're getting the weights for free, the biases for free, all worked out for us. But to do that, we have to basically work out the mean of the ImageNet data that it was trained on and be able to do our pre-processing and stuff. So that's all that's doing is doing pre-processing. Then we set up our network. So here we've got our conf block and our res block. These are basically just like I described before. We pass in some things to do with X is input in here, number of filters, filter size, number of strides. Also, we pass in whether we're using activation or not, because remember, on the second layer of our res block, as you can see down here, we don't use we don't always use activation. Actually, we don't use it usually at all. All right, we use it on the first conf block of ResNet, the first conf block of a residual module or a residual block, but not on the second one. And you can see exactly what I was saying before is that here you're basically on the res block, you're basically all I'm doing is processing it, and then I'm merging it, I'm adding it together, I'm merging it by sum. So I'm just adding those two things together at the end to get our output. Okay, here's where the magic happens. The upsampling block, aka the deconvolution or transpose convolution or fractionally strident convolutions. Lots of ways to say the same thing, or say basically the same thing. Here what we're doing is I'm just using the Keras upsampling layer. So what this layer does is it allows us to basically put something in, and it does its strides at, normally we talk about 2x2 strides. This is actually doing strides at half. So what you get out of that is you get expanded pixels. And you can see here's the upsampling network. I've got basically the res, I've got my convolutional block, my res block, res block, res block, res block, then two of the upsampling blocks. And then we've got the last convolutional to basically get it out, get it down to 3 color channels. We use tan activation on it, but actually, if we didn't, it turns out now apparently that the author of the paper has said that the tan activation is not, you don't have to use it. You can get away with not using that. Because we're using tan activation though, and because my output is going to be an image that I want to be able to show and stuff, I need to then convert that back into an image. So I do that basically because we're between negative 1 and 1, I add 1 and I times by 127.5 to basically get us back to the 0 to 255 for a pixel. Okay, so here you can see this is the, one of the cool things about Keras is that we can just do the model, and Keras is very simple to make models. You basically can just, you can see here, I've basically told it what I want to put as my input, what I want to put, as my output, and I've made that into a model, and then straight away I can just do model.summary, and it prints out all this wonderful information for me. And here I can see that, okay, the shape that I'm putting in is a 44 by 44 by 3 channels. So this is our low res image, right? It's 44 pixels by 44 pixels by 3 channels deep. All right, you can see when it comes out at 176 by 176 by 3. Now, I'm not going to go through and walk through each layer, but you can go through and read, you know, what each layer is doing quite easily. This is one of the good things about Keras, is actually that it allows you very quickly to visualize a model. We can see the amount of parameters that we've got going on. All of it's there. But the most important thing is that we're going in with a low res and we're coming out with a normal resolution. Okay. Now we've got our VGG networks. So we're going to have two networks here. But what we're going to do is we're not going to use the entire network. Just as Martin chopped off, remember, you know, in his example, he chopped off a bunch of stuff to get access to, you know, one of the convolutional blocks. We're doing exactly the same thing. And the block that we're going to chop off at is one of the early ones. Because if you think about it, ImageNet, as the further along you go, the more that the networks, if it's been trained on ImageNet, the more it's going to start to understand big objects. So, you know, just at your sort of last few layers before, say, the dense layer, it knows what a cat looks like. It knows what a face looks like. It knows what an eyeball looks like. It's got a good sense of all those things. We don't really want that. You know, we want something, because we're not trying to train. If we were trying to train on all of ImageNet for our thing, we could do that. But really what we want more are lines, corners, edges, you know, small sort of shapes that the early layers pick up. Because then it will be able to use those to basically sort of pick those up in a full resolution image and a low resolution image and work out, this should be that. And it will then get a sense of, okay, a curved line in a low resolution image looks totally different than a curved line in a normal resolution image. Okay, so if you can see this, the VGG network is very small, right? After we chop that stuff off, we do, you know, and I do the summary, we don't have a lot there at all. We've basically just got, you know, a bit of convolution, a bit of max pooling. But you can see this is then, we've gone from 176 by 176 with three layers deep, and we come out, okay, it's not, you know, as wide and it's not as high, but we come out with 128 filters. And those 128 filters is where it's storing all this magical information. And that's what we're going to then use to calculate our loss. So going through Keras, basically Keras has a really cool thing that anything you want to turn into a model, you can basically just throw it, you know, you can take it and turn it into a layer using a lambda, and then you can basically just take that and stick that in a model to use that. And this is what I'm sort of doing here, is I'm basically starting to assemble it all together. So that when I do a pass, I'm going through all three networks in the order that I want them to be going through them. Okay, here's our loss function. And then basically the final sort of full model that we put together is going to be, you know, we're going to be feeding in all these things. We're going to be using Atom. We're going to be using mean squared error for our loss. We then start training. Saving weights, loading weights, and then finally some predictions. So on the left you can see this is our low res image, and on the right is the prediction for 4x of that. And we can see that the model clearly has learned a lot. Now the interesting thing here, let me just check something. Yes, okay. So this is still, this one, you know, this one we can see really it's learned quite a lot. I haven't done, I haven't done thousands of epochs of training either. I've deliberately sort of limited the amount of training to get it just enough to sort of start learning. If I was going to do this as a production model, I would get, you know, as much data as I could. I would train it for, you know, as forever, well, you know, as long as I could. But here we can see already, without a lot of training, it's already starting to pick up stuff. Now, this is still on our training data, right? So we'd expect that it should understand something, you know, reasonably well. And we can see that, like, it's starting to get the concept of, like, if you look at the girl's hair here, it's starting to understand that sort of hair is a continuous line. It's, you know, it's not blocky. It starts to fill those things out. Here's a good one. All the curves. It's really got a good sense of that curve there on her, you know, on her hair. It's got a, it's starting to fill in the eyes and to work out that, okay, these sort of blobs of black over here, black and gray, actually should be turned into something. That this sort of light color here, which really is almost the same color as, you know, parts of her skin, over here it's worked out that, okay, that's her teeth. That's comparing to the original. So this is the low res input. This is our prediction on the right. Again, our prediction on the right, this is the ground truth image here. It's not bad, right? But that's still just predicting on training data. So let's look at some, let's predict on test data. So here's an example of, do people know who this is? Does anyone know who this is? Yes. Yes, the CEO of Baidu, right? So this is an image that the network hasn't seen at all, right? And you can see it's done a pretty good job of it. It's worked out, you know, that, okay, that this sort of, all these sort of blobs here really are a mouth. You know, perhaps it hasn't done very well with the light on the side. If we look at the ground truth, and this is the prediction, so here's one of the interesting things about this data set. If you want to lose wrinkles, if you want to lose, you know, anything as a celebrity, just train on enough celebrities and it will just wipe them all away. You will see this more. Look at this one. So here's a lady. On the left is the low-res input. On the right is the prediction. Right? This is the 4x prediction. And again, this is the ground truth versus here. Can see that it's done a pretty nice job of getting, smoothing out her skin, at least, you could say. But here's the cool thing, is that with a CNN, another one of the things about that makes CNN so magical is that they don't care about size of input or size of output. The way CNNs work, you know, really, the size of input, size of output, you know, will vary. Obviously, if you put, you know, a different input in, you'll get a different output, but they, you can basically mess with them. So what I've done here is I've built a new model, right? So in Keras, we have to do this by building a new model to just tell it, that basically all we're doing is telling it a new pixel size for the input. And what I've done is I'm now predicting on our prediction. So I've taken the image that was a quarter size, blown it up by 4 times to the normal size, and now we're blowing that up 4 times again. So we're actually doing 16x prediction here. And you see, it's not bad. For such little training, it's really got a good sense of hair here, right? You can see that this is our new one on the left. This is our old one on the right. We can see that it's really, you know, it's got a strong sense of hair, it's got a strong sense of curves. What it doesn't have is a strong sense of text. Notice all the text in the background, it just doesn't get any of it right. Because this data set has had no text in it. So we wouldn't expect it to have learned anything about, you know, text. Now, if we trained it on all of ImageNet or something like that, it probably would pick up those sorts of things. And if we threw in a lot of, say, commercial images with text and fonts or things like that, it would definitely pick up those sorts of things. So again, this is the original low-res image that we started out with. This is 16 times the resolution. Not bad. Let's look at 8x. So exactly the same network. All I've done now is I've thrown in, and I've done this in a very lazy way to show that you can try these ideas out very quickly. All I've done is thrown in one extra block of upsampling. So that we start with 22, and we end with 176. In theory, we should definitely train this model longer than we trained the first one. You can see this one's done pretty nice. On the training data, that's really now starting to get her eyes. You're going from that. You know, I like to, you know, this is where I say we're starting to reach CSI territory. You know, like I showed this to my wife, and my wife was like, oh, so what? They do that on CSI all the time, right? And I had to explain to her that actually, up until recently, it's been bullshit when they did it on, you know, CSI or whatever. But we are getting into the territory now where we can take something that really is, you know, totally pixelated junk and turn it into something that the model, you know, makes as a proper face. Look at that one. That's nice. And this is a perfect example of what I mean by the celebrity face. Remember, if you see her first one, she's got a little bit of blemishes. Don't worry. Just stick you into the 8x, you know, celebrity data set. We can fix that. When I showed this to Martin came up with a great idea of, why don't you train up like a whole bunch of really old faces, then we could make an app that basically just, you took a selfie and it would show you what you're gonna look like when you're old. And you could do this for like, you know, this turn this into an app and you would have a celebrity, you know, sort of selfie app. But you can see there, it's really got, you know, it's really got a face. Really has a very strong understanding of a face here. Okay, predicting on training data. That was predicting on training data. Now let's look at predicting on test data. Look at this one. Now, remember last time I showed you about GANs? And we talked about how the generative, you know, adversarial network, how the GAN basically is constantly trying to trick the discriminating network. This is a good example of sort of almost like a GAN image, where if you look at it, now, if I just showed you that, right, and you'd never seen this lady's face before, you probably would think, wow, that's amazing. And it is amazing, because it looks like a lady, and it looks like, you know, someone's real face and stuff, but it's not the same lady. You look at this one. You can see that it's getting to the point, as humans, we can kind of say, well, it's someone different, or there's something. You know, we're a little bit in the uncanny valley there of where there's something that, as humans, we can detect very quickly. But this would certainly pass a GAN, I would say, because it certainly looks like a real, you know, real human face. And you can see also that it's really got. Okay, so it's interesting to look at this one to sort of see what the network has learnt. It really has a sense of that hair should have a shine on it, right? If you're a celebrity, you want shiny hair. And it's also sort of learned to fix up sort of errant hairs that stick out. See, this lady's got like, hair's a little bit messy maybe on the side. No problem, we put you through the celebrity treatment. It fixes it out, smooths it all up. Okay, so let's look at now doing a prediction on the prediction for the 8x, so we're now getting to 64x territory. This shouldn't work at all, right? If you think about even just like your iPhone zoom or something like that, when you're doing digital zoom and you zoom in, it looks like crap. In future, I'm sure you'll start to see these things used in phones for things like zoom, for sure. Look at it. It's not right, but it is interesting. So it's definitely got, you know, a little bit more sense of the sort of lips. It's certainly played with the color, but there's definitely getting quite serious artifacts happening now. But it is, don't forget, this is, we're putting in, we put in a 22 by 22 image, and now we're up to, what is it, 1400 or something. You know, so we started with 22 by 22 pixels, we're now up to 1400 by 1400 pixels. It shouldn't work at all when you think about it. So that gives you an example of the code. I will put the code up online so that you can go through it. Where's my presentation? So here's what I was sort of getting at before. If you start to think that, well, gee, if I just put a CNN between any input, any image in, and any image out, maybe I can train this CNN to do something. And you can, right? You totally can. Colorization. I actually started coding this up. I didn't get it finished to show you, but basically this is, you know, is doing exactly the same thing. Basically what we do is we make a data set, we just take, you know, a set of images, we you know, write a script that basically makes a grayscale version of them. We train on the grayscale, go into the color, calculate the perceptual loss. And the perceptual loss is the really important thing here, is it's not like pixel loss. This is the power that makes this stuff work, is this concept of perceptual loss. And then we can basically do colorization. We can do segmentation. Now, segmentation we would probably use slightly different network. We'd probably go down first, and then we would go up in the same network. The reason we go down, down sample first on the first half of the network, is so that we get, that ability to see as much of the image as possible in one filter. And this, you know, the probably the best stuff for doing this stuff now, it would be dense nets, and before that would be U-nets. I think there's going to be a big new paper coming out about this soon. So, but these, you know, this is very easy to do once you've got, you know, this concept going. Other ones, depth perception. If you can train up a network to understand that certain things are a certain depth, you can use that. Denoising, you know, taking noise out of images. Any sort of visual filter that you wanted to create, you could use this. Audio clarity, super resolution for audio is one of the things that, you know, Martin and I have talked a lot about. Also audio filters. So if you can take, something like a recording of a guitar, an electric guitar, and being played, and then run that exact same recording through a beautiful, nice, big Marshall stack amplifier and record that, you would eventually be able to train something that could kind of emulate that. The challenge there, and someone asked before about audio stuff, the challenge with the audio stuff is, okay, what are you going to use as your loss function? What kind of CNN? Because audio, we generally tend to convert it into some sort of spectrogram or something like that. That's not probably the best way of doing it. I think going forward over this year, next year, over the next couple of years, we'll probably work out better ways to calculate getting a loss from two audio things. And that will then see a massive advance in things like the Tachotron model and a whole bunch of different things. But anyway, summary. I want you to understand that, you know, generative models doesn't just mean like let's make artsy stuff. I happen to think that the neural style transfer is really one of the coolest things to play around with. You can come up with amazing images. But it's really understanding that you can use these in your work a lot. Anytime you need something that goes image in, image out. Again, power of CNNs goes way beyond classification. Perceptual loss comes from two CNNs. The whole concept of image in, image out. So, you know, I challenge you to go home and come up with an idea for this, right? And ideally come up with an idea that someone hasn't done. right? Because there's probably still hundreds of different things that people haven't done for this kind of thing. And you can certainly do it. That's it. I'll put the code up on GitHub later tonight, so you can download it, train it, play with it, abuse it, whatever you want. Any questions?
Is the key thing about the loss, because you're using a mean square error,
So
when you compare two images, there's some universal quality index, which some of them are perceptually mapped to a mean opinion score, so people, it's really perceptually.
Yes, you can also use MAE as well as the MSE, but when I was testing it out, the MSE just seemed to work so much easier. Given more time, I would probably play with the MAE as well, because certain new papers have actually shown that there are probably lots of different ways you can do it, right? The key thing though is that you're using the CNNs as kind of like a filter to make up all these cool feature sets for you, which you then compare against each other. And the loss that it's getting in those things is not, it's things that it sees in the image. That's one of the reasons why it's not getting the text well, is it on the training model, it doesn't see enough text. So it just doesn't think that that's important. It basically, cancels it out. And using that data set, that's totally expected. It would be very cool to do, here's my challenge to someone. Go and make, and this would be probably pretty easy to make too, make a network exactly like this that just takes fonts and takes a font and scales that up. You could probably come up with a really cool way for scaling fonts. That would be something that would be reasonably easy to do and to try out. Other questions? Right.
I don't remember if you have information of them, but probably it doesn't matter, but probably you can get better results in a pre-processing step.
Let me look at my pre-processing. Okay, so here I've missed the channels by doing negative one, right? So it is getting it back to RGB. Other questions? Yeah, so one of the things that I think I'm sure people are probably working on this already, but here's a startup for you, right? Take this model, take a bunch of pictures of people walking by in high res and low res, train up a model for that, sell it to the NSA, right? Or sell it to some sort of security force so that they have the ability to take camera footage and zoom in on it. And it's totally doable. I think there's anything where you could even train up models for things where things are being censored with pixelation, that you could do this. There's another startup idea for you, right? But you can certainly use it for any sort of thing. You just want to use different training data. Right? And the cool thing about this is it's very easy to make training data. You just go and take a bunch of high-resolution images, and then you use a script to basically downsample them. Right? And this is for all those things I showed you. The segmentation is not quite as easy, but for things like colorization, denoising, all those sorts of things, it's very easy to make mountains of training data to train on. To hack? In how? Explain to me what you mean. And make a high resolution of the eye to put it in front of a camera? There's your startup idea. not that I know of, I would not put it past people. It allows you to, if you can build a training set of enough eyes close up You could definitely do this. So some serious real-world applications of this would be things like, you know, microscopes, taking taking sort of medium resolutions, or you know, going from medium resolution to high resolution digitally in a microscope. That would be really useful for things like studying cells, studying blood, you know, all those sorts of things. This, you know, again, getting back to why I sort of say, don't think of generative models as purely being artistic models. That's not what it's about. Look, you could do that. With the biometric stuff, you could do it. I did laugh at something I saw on TV the other night, of where they took a picture of a glass that was in the picture and then zoomed in and took the fingerprints off the picture. I don't think you can do that, right? But who knows in the future? I really don't think you can do that. Any other questions?
Have you tried, what would it take to apply this to NVIDIA?
Not much at all. Just GPU. Okay.
Is there any research about, because video has obviously got time dimension as well as X and Y.
Yes, but you could just train it on each of the, you could just take a training set and train it like that. There may be better ways. So for example, like the style transfer for video, the first way of doing style transfer doesn't work so well for video, and it, basically because it's sort of bringing out, you get lots of alternatives that are not coherent when you string them together, if that makes sense. You get lots of alternatives that make sense when you're just looking at it as a still picture, like, oh yes, this could be a Van Gogh picture, and this could be a Van Gogh picture, but this Van Gogh picture has got the house is being blue, and in this Van Gogh picture, it's got the house is being yellow, sort of thing. That sort of thing. But there's a number of papers where they fix that. It's basically just stabilizing, you know, the model. But yeah, you could do this for videos quite easily. It shouldn't be that difficult. Any other questions? One here, and then. Yeah, you know, if you create enough training data and that video is reasonably similar to your training data, obviously if you take, you know, so it would be interesting to, you know, one of the things that Martin was curious about was like, put a cat image in it, you know, see what happens. It would be interesting, yeah, to take like, you know, if you put in different sorts of data in there, you know, it won't work as well, that's for sure. So that's where you come to training on all of ImageNet or something like that. Then it will be able to work on a whole bunch of different things. But yeah, you know, you could certainly do that. It's not a fully connected layer. So it's the last layer is a convolutional layer. The purpose of using 10H is to basically get it to be between negative 1 and positive 1. That said, you know, like I mentioned before, the author of the paper since has said that they went back and tried it without 10H, and it worked pretty much the same. You could, yeah. You can certainly try something like that. Mess with it, right? You know, that's the whole purpose of putting the code up, is mess with it, try it, see what happens. Right. Any other questions? All done? Okay, I know we've gone quite late tonight. Thank you for coming. So, yes, you do too. do you want to come up? So, a few announcements. So the next event will be on the 25th. And what we're starting to do now is make a topic for each night. So like, last month and this night, or tonight, definitely was sort of generative.